next talk will be on lithium yttrium borate. It will be given by Dr. Lengiel.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I will speak about lithium yttrium borate single crystals and the incorporation of some kind of rare earth ions into these crystals. I am working in Budapest in the Institute for Solid State Physics and Optics. First, I will speak about a little the lithium yttrium borate crystal, about the properties and why it is interesting. Then I will show you that how to grow this crystal in our institute with dysprosium, erbium, and ytterbium ions. And then I will show some spectroscopic results about the electronic levels of dysprosium ions in lithium yttrium borate. This is interesting because up to now in the literature, usually it was measured only in polycrystals, so powders, but now it has the possibility to measure it in single crystals. Then I will show some results on saturation spectroscopy in erbium and ytterbium lithium yttrium borates. And then as a consequence of the result of the ytterbium saturation spectroscopy, I will show some spectroscopic results about the ytterbium pairs in lithium yttrium borates. And then I will show you some kind of calculation that say the theory about the possibility of the ytterbium pairs in lithium yttrium borate crystals. So the lithium yttrium borate crystals is a monoclinic crystal, so a little harder to make experimental like in lithium niobate. It is an excellent nonlinear optical material, and it is a very good candidate for laser host or scintillation application because in the yttrium sites, the rare earth ions can incorporate without any lattice distortions. As a consequence, more or less all of the lithium rare earth borate crystals has this crystal structure. Here you can see just to show the structure, and this B direction is a two folded axis. So, our department worked on the lithium yttrium borate growth of this crystal, and we determined the phase diagram, the area of the phase diagram where we can grow the crystal. And then we put interesting rare earth ions in the crystal, and one can see that we have very good quality optical crystals. And we put different concentrations of these rare earth ions, and we check these concentrations by chemical analysis methods. And we realized that it goes into the crystal, so it likes the crystal. So, first, start with the dysprosium lithium yttrium borate crystals. We measured with high resolution absorption spectrometer in a wide range from 3000 reciprocal centimeter up to 40,000 reciprocal centimeter to check that the properties of the dysprosium ions in the crystal and or colleagues in Tartu, Professor Vitali and Ivo Romer, measured the luminescence of these samples. And everybody can see that we have very good bands. We can distinguish a lot of transitions. And after all, we realize that we can identify all of the crystal field levels in these crystals up to the 4i50 half level. So we are very happy. but we really didn't find any spectroscopic anomalies. This proton is in the crystal, and there is no large lattice distortion. So we had some older measurements on lithium, erbium-doped lithium yttrium borate. And then we started to make some kind of new measurements, the so-called saturation spectroscopy, which you heard in the first invited talk here, yes? And just in short, if we first illuminate the crystal with a high-intensity laser impulse, and then we switch off the laser, and then we make a frequency scanning near that frequency which was the illuminating laser, then we will see that in the absorption band we have some kind of hole. This is called the absorption hole. We have this setup where the laser frequency can be changed in the laser, or if we need a faster way, then with an acousto-optic modulator. And then what we see in the erbium-doped lithium ytterbium crystal, we use in this measurement the lowest level of this electronic transition. And it is in the other direction, the absorption hole, because this is a transmission measurement. And you can see here that you have an absorption hole, and in the background you can see the fundamental absorption. So this is this kind of Lorentz. So this is the background because of the absorption hole, because we are somewhere in the top of the absorption band. So it is very good. We can determine the T1, T2 values of these ions, but here again, the erbium just show that, okay, I am here, and I have this T1, T2 values, and that's all. But when we put the ytterbium-doped lithium yttrium borate crystal into this setup, and we illuminate the lowest energy of this transition, so the highest absorption band, then we realize that we have something like a doubled absorption hole. And we really don't understand first that why we see a doubled absorption hole. And we measure the T1, which is the population relaxation time, and the T2, which is the deeper relaxation time of this transition. And we realize that there are big differences between these two. And I searched a lot in the literature, and we concluded that maybe it came from the pairs from the crystal. And so one of the absorption holes comes from the standalone ytterbiums, and the other from the ytterbium pairs. And if we have ytterbium pairs in the crystal, then what else can you measure then? And I found a good article of Professor Zubera, and they have a very wide experimental in EPR, luminescence, absorption, correlation measurements, and they found that there is an absorption band at 977 nanometer, which corresponds to ytterbium pairs. Okay, let's see. Find this absorption band in our samples. And I used a high resolution, 0.05 reciprocal centimeter, and I realized that this absorption band, which is correspond to the ytterbium pairs, has a fine structure. So all of the older articles, they have only just one band, but this is because they don't have such kind of resolution. And we can see that with the ytterbium concentration, it increases. Yes, of course, we can see the big absorption band with a lot of fibronic bands. So here we can see everything on this sample. And then I checked the polarization dependence of these absorption bands. Yes, it is not so easy in a monoclinic crystal, but if I use this kind of sample, the O1O cut sample, which means that the twofold axis came out from the plate, from the sample, then I realized that between the minimum and the maximum absorption has a very big difference. So no such kind of difference of the absorption bands which related to the ytterbium ions. And if somebody can imagine that, what does this mean? This means that somehow this transition are oriented in the direction of the yttrium chain of the structure. It's not so easy. It needs to see the structure a lot of times. So after that, I tried to check that it was written in the articles that this ytterbium pair transitions are not so strongly coupled to the crystal lattice. So this means that if you make some kind of temperature dependence, if you go from 9 Kelvin to 300 Kelvin, sorry about I forgot to write the temperatures somehow, then you can see that at room temperature it vanished completely. And I made a Gaussian fit to this very big spectra. And if you just see the position, no, the half width of this highest absorption band component, then you can see first that up to 70 Kelvin, you really don't have any changes. So it can say that, yes, it is more or less independent from the lattice. And yes, then of course, there is the more or less standard temperature dependence of the parameters of the absorption band. And with the one phonon coupling model, you can say that this absorption band coupled with a 200 reciprocal centimeter phonon group. And it is somehow similarly to the broad spectra also. It maybe the broad spectra is corresponds to the ytterbium pairs, and the other is the standalone ions. I tried to utilize the Siesta software somehow to check that it is energetically favorable or not, the ytterbium pairs in the lithium-yttrium borate crystals. This software has a very good properties, and the SuperSEM method is already inside the software. And I use a 212 unit cell, which means that I have 304 atoms in the unit cell. And then I put an ytterbium ion here in the middle in a yttrium site. And then I put a second ytterbium ion in a lot of places, 15 different places in this supercell, and just relax the structure, just everything just leave to relax. And after that, I realized that the total energy of the supercell, which is now, if I found any differences just because the two ytterbium are in different places, the minima of this total energy is the two closest neighbor. You can see these are the closest neighbor, this 3.85 angstrom. And the first is 0. This one is the 0.115 electron volt. So that means that this energy, this 0.12 electron volt, is really if you see from the crystal growth, then at the temperature of the crystal growth, you can say that it is not so big. But when you cool down the crystal at room temperature, it is a big difference. So that means that ytterbium pairs energetically the favorable. So the conclusions dysprosium, doblithium, yttrium borate crystals, we successfully identified up to that level, all of the crystal field levels. We show the double spectral hole in the lithium, yttrium borate, doblithium, ytterbium crystal. And then we show that the ytterbium pair absorption band has a fine structure. And I made some kind of calculations which show that the ytterbium pair formations are energetically favorable in this crystal. So thanks for your attention. And thanks, everything.
Maybe one quick, very quick question, Rob. Very quick.
Christian, why did you choose to do this with DFT when it would be much easier to do it with GULP?
Yes, I know you would like to ask why I don't use the GULP code.
No, but you're using a sledgehammer to crack a nut.
No, yes, this is the reason.
To use a technical term.
Technically, I have a lot of result in lithium niobate using Siesta. And then I realized that I can make some kind of calculations with using Siesta with a lot of types of crystals like this one. So for these calculations, it would be very interesting to use the other software and to compare it, that it is the same or not. But I think that DFT calculations are in this manner is better.
I think maybe in order to keep us on time, we'll.
Okay. Usually when we are looking at ytterbium pairs, yes, we are going to 500 nanometer, you see, to see cooperative emission. Did you check?
The cooperative transition, this was my first idea, but unfortunately, after some experiment, I realized that there is a result that if you... there is an article, an old article, and it is written that the distance between the ytterbium pairs, the ytterbiums, and the absorption coefficient has some kind of decrease, and this distance is too big. So in this distance, this 3.85 angstrom, you have something like a minus, if you follow that linear. I will show you that article. I will send you that article. I just realized, and then I need a very long sample, maybe.
Okay, let's thank the speaker one more time.